stage. Good morning, all, and welcome to this day of worship. Before we begin our worship time, we have a few announcements that we're going to discuss and share together. I'll invite you, as I always do, to post those announcements and prayer concerns on our Facebook page during our live service. We continue to lift up one another in prayer throughout the service, but most specifically at the prayers of the people after our sermon today. On our announcements today, we want to mention the update to our mission outreach this month. It is Together for TIPA, a great ministry of serving kids and individuals in need in our community, specifically providing school products for students who may not have all the equippings they need. Also, they reach out with Christmas gifts at times, just a way to get in the trenches with those who are less fortunate within our local community. Our goal is $500 this month. We've already reached, it looks like I had the 350. I saw 3530 there for a minute, and I thought, wait a minute, that's our budget goal. But thank you for all of you who continue to equip our ministry by sharing and giving and living outside of yourself for the sake of others. That seems to be what the church is about, doesn't it? So thank you. Are there other announcements that we want to mention verbally this morning or share with our worship community before we lift up our prayer concerns and joys today? Okay, if there are none, we have several that we want to add to our prayer list this morning. A number of individuals who are part of our church family, members of our church, died this week, and we want to lift up those families and friends. Billy Mooney, longtime member of our church, went to be with the Lord at the nice, ripe age of 93 this week. We celebrated her life in worship yesterday at the Walnut Creek Church, and grateful for Billy, and continue to pray for her family and loved ones. We also want to be prayerful for Marie Bullock's family. That's our very own Joey Bullock's grandmother. We continue to ask for comfort and peace to that family as they grieve her loss. In addition, Miss Francis, I just drew a blank on Jordan. Yes, I had Vince. I didn't have Jordan. Miss Francis Jordan, who is the mother of our own Vince Jordan, grandmother of our Jenna Jordan Hopper. So we lift up that family. They'll celebrate her life this Tuesday at a private service at Antioch Cemetery. The family of Coleman Beavers, we want to remember, and the family of Anita Elrod. Also, some joys, even as we share concerns. I heard from Margaret Montgomery this morning that she and Kent are behind the worst of COVID. So we give thanks there because they had a really tough battle. She said, we're going to be watching this morning. She may have already posted. Margaret, we love you all. Your church family does. And we continue to pray for you. And she said, Mary John Deal has gotten her first shot. And she's a tough old gal. She may have even said something more rough than that. But anyway, I'm going to hold it at that. May have said old bird. I don't know. Maybe that was it. Mary John would have said something rougher than that about herself, though. But we're grateful that she is staying well and has received her first vaccine. I'm kind of checking the notes as we go along, too, any other new updates or prayer concerns. We do want to continue to remember Peggy and Mike Parker. Mike's pneumonia has given him quite a time as a result of COVID. Now, Jennifer, has he been hospitalized or he just went back there? Went back to a checkup with his physician, but continue to remember Mike and Peggy, our beloved members, who are still dealing with the effects of COVID-19. Other updates or additions today to our prayer list. Okay, if there are none, friends, this is the day our Lord has made. Let us worship him now in joy and in gladness. Our call to worship this day is from Psalm 62. For God alone my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. Trust in Him at all times. O people, pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us. Friends, will you join me now as we share together in a prayer of confession, followed by a few moments of silent confession. Dear Heavenly Father, we lower our heads before You, and we confess that we have too often forgotten that we are Yours. Sometimes we carry on our lives as if there was no God, and we fall short of being a credible witness to You. For these things we ask Your forgiveness, and we also ask for Your strength. Give us clear minds and open hearts so we may witness to You in our world. Remind us to be who You would have us to be, regardless of what we are doing or who we are with. Hold us to You and build our relationship with those You have given us on earth. Amen. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace and love in which we stand, and we boast in the hope of sharing the glory of God. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Be at peace.
Today's Old Testament reading comes from the book of Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed His mind about the calamity that He had said He would bring upon them, and He did not do it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Oh God, we thank You for Your holy word that gives us life. And as You promise in Your scripture, not only do we live through Your grace, but we have life more abundantly. As we have heard this reading of Your Old Testament text, we pray that You illuminate us and as Your people in Your world, that we will be Your light. Even as these words breathe life into us, may we breathe life into this world around us as Your witness. And now as we receive Your gospel reading, O God, will You continue to give us the ears to hear, the eyes to see, and the hearts to receive your call upon us as your church, as your people, to be love in the world around us. For your glory and in your holy name we pray. Amen. So today's gospel reading is from Mark chapter 1. I'll begin with verse 14 and continue down through verse 20. Listen with me for the word of the Lord. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. And he said, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near, and believe in the good news as you repent." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting their nets into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them. They left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Last week, if you'll remember, and I know it'll be a challenge for you to remember because I had to go back and look at what we talked about last week too. We began examining God's call upon our lives as his children, that we all have a call. Certainly some are called to professional or ordained ministry, but all of us are called to be light and love in the world around us. As we spoke about that call last week, we identified some attributes of how God places the call upon our life. We examined the call of Samuel, the boy ministering in the temple, and we used that acronym CALL to distinguish some ways that God uses those around us and the Holy Spirit works in us to offer us a call in our profession, in our family, maybe a move, maybe a change to a new ministry within or even without side of the church. One of the letters that we saw exemplified in Samuel's calling was the C. We search for consensus, those who we respect and journey with in our faith. The Spirit will speak the same affirming word to them as we hear. There is a consensus in God's call. The A of how God calls us. God calls us when we are attentive, when we are obedient, willing, and eager to serve and to follow. The first L of God's call upon our lives is when we listen, when we are eager to actually hear from God. Not only always in our prayers to talk to God, but searching the Spirit for what God may be wanting to say to us. And finally, Samuel's other example of how God initiates the call in our life is that God calls us legibly. It's clear. It's not hard to figure out. It's not as if we're reading Greek when we search for what God is saying to us. No, the call is crystal clear. I even said last week, if we have to ask if God is calling us to something, then God is probably not calling us to something. At least at that point, it may be part of the discernment. When we get to that point of response, it will be so clear that we don't even have to ask the question. The yes and the amen will be there. Those are the things that we talked about last week on how God calls. Now, why couldn't I just preach a 5-minute sermon last week if I just gave y'all the whole thing again, right? Can't tell y'all all my tricks. Got to hold back something, John. But today, we transition in the gospel text for looking at how God issues the call to us, to more of an understanding, as we see written here in the gospel, of what is the result of God's call upon our life, God's call upon us as a family, in our daily work, and in our eagerness to be receptive, to embrace new ministries, or even that scary word, change, in our life and in the life of those we love. You know, there's one sentence in our text today that I really want to focus on, and it's the only sentence where Jesus is quoted within this gospel reading in Mark chapter 1, beginning with verse 14, where he says to those that he issues the call to, what would become his disciples, right? He says these words, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." See, Jesus was talking to fishermen. And he spoke to them in the language that they understood. Remember, we spoke earlier of God's call being legible and clear unto us. And as I consider the words of Jesus' call here to the fishermen, there's some of us who are real fishermen, like Doc Howell back there. And there's some of us who are fake fishermen, like Kenny Hill and me. We've journeyed out on that lake before, not caught a thing, haven't we, Kenny? In this call, we hear where Jesus said those words, and let's remember who it was he's talking to. It says that the fishermen, Randall, were in the boat mending their nets. You know what that tells me? Fishing's hard work. The mending of the nets wouldn't be any fun, would it? This wasn't simply something they were doing to entertain themselves. This was their livelihood. It was their profession. Sometimes it's hard work. So friend, when God places a call upon us, transitioning to a new ministry, hearing a new service that God wants us to embrace on behalf of our community, or the world around us, let's don't be so naive to believe that it'll be easy. And on the other side, when it gets hard, let's don't simply think, well, this must not be of God. This world is filled with challenges, right? And our calling, the way that God calls us to walk, is no different. It will continue to be a lifetime of work. Not only do we hear that it is not always easy to embrace and embody being Christ-like in the world around us, but also I'm reminded in these words of Jesus what he says too, "Follow me and I'll make you fish for people." Now, there's a wise old saying among fishermen, there's a reason that it's called fishing and not catching. You don't always catch, right? In other words, in the ways of the world, our ministry, our call, we will not always be successful in the ways of the world. Have I got you fully depressed now upon the call? I've shared with you that it's hard work, and I've shared with you that it always won't be necessarily your identification or those around you's identification of what it means to be successful. Last night, Manya and I went out and visited with our friend Pam Verdung and Jill Clark and had a nice gathering. The guys were away, so I was the only rooster at a hen party. And I did what any good rooster would do. I went in the other room and took a nap and let them continue to have their party. In that party, as we were gathering and talking, and we talked about Chris Clark, Jill's husband, my friend, being a fisherman. And Jill is, Chris is multi-talented. Not only is he a fisherman, he's also a plumber. He came to our house once to do some work, and we were both gone, and I gave him the code to our garage so he could just let himself in. Isn't that good about living in a small town? You know people, you trust people, you have friends who are going to do you a good job. Chris called me a few minutes later, and he said, "This garage code's not working." I gave it to him again. He said, "It's still not working." He said, "I've done everything. You want me to go around and go in one of the windows?" And I said, "Well, you could do that." And he said, "Now, wait a minute. Is your front door white?" I said, "No, my front door's gray." He said, "I'm at the wrong house." Now, here, let's examine that. If Chris had persisted, he could have gotten in the house, right? Now, it probably would not have been a good result, and certainly not the result he had desired. He could have forced his way in there, right? But he didn't have come in the front door, and he wouldn't have had a welcoming reception. Friends, our passage says in our text that Jesus proclaimed to the disciples, "Listen with me again. Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." You see, my friend Chris, comically as we heard there, he went to the wrong place or in the wrong direction. Friends, one way that we are sure and certain to be in the right way in our ministry, hey, let's break it down further. To be in the right way in our family's journey together, to be in the right way as a coach, as an educator, as a leader in our community, to be in the right way and go to the right place where that code is always going to answer when we try to enter is when we do this, when we follow Christ. He will lead us in the right path. You see, oftentimes, I'm tempted to get ahead of Christ. I'm tempted to say, "God, I've got a great plan. Why don't you follow me in my arrogance?" But the Scripture, the call of our Lord today, is the same for us as it was for the disciples. Jesus says, if you want to go in the right path for your family, for your church, for your community, then begin by doing this. Follow me. Isn't that reassuring? Because, you know, I don't have the best sense of navigation. Manya's so much better than me. My dad's wonderful at finding direction, staying on the path. I'll get lost. And it's so reassuring for me to know I don't have to know the way. All I have to know in my life and ministry to go in the right path is to follow in the steps of Christ. Jesus said, "Come to me when you're weary and burdened, and I'll give you rest, and follow me, and I'll lead you in the right path to fish for people." That's encouraging. That's reassuring. But here's the thing. Some of you may be saying today, and to be honest, I don't know who this sermon is for today. I'm sure there's words through the Holy Spirit for all of us. But some of you, maybe, if there's someone listening who's wrestling with a new call in their life, in their profession, or in a physical move in some way, that you may be saying, "Jody, here's the thing. I don't know how to do it. I'm not prepared. I don't seem to have the skills." We may have those same excuses, if that's the word we want to use, that Moses did, right? "I'm too old. I've got a bad past. I got a bad temper. I don't know how to talk." Friends, here is the truth of our text. Did you hear, once again, that sentence where Jesus ordered or called upon his disciples and he said, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." He didn't say, "Follow me because you're already a good fisherman." He didn't say, "Follow me because you've got the words of eloquence or the gifts of leadership." He said, "Follow me and I will make you what I need for you to serve the world to my Father's glory." See, my friend Chris, the fisherman, Jill told me last night, she said, Chris hardly watches TV. Only thing he'll watch on his phone, something about fishing. To help him learn more about it, Doc. See, God doesn't call the equipped. God equips the called. He equips us when we have a discerning and a willing heart, like that fisherman that wants to learn more about their trade. We study the scripture. We spend time in prayer. We spend time with God, and we're receptive to learning more and being equipped by the one who calls. My friend Kenneth Drury, who we worked with for many years in our construction operation at Hill Brothers Construction, was wrestling with a call to professional ministry at one time in his life. And Ken and I had some discussions about the call and my journey to faith and how the Holy Spirit placed that call upon me. And I was willing to journey with Kenneth along that path. And he told me a story once, Jason, of how God ultimately made that call clear and legible in his life. Ken said, I was going hunting one Sunday and I was just miserable. You know, I'd been wrestling with the call. I couldn't find any peace, Randall. He said, I was searching for affirmation. And I shouldn't have been hunting anyway. It was on Sunday. And it was early before church. So I thought, I've just got to get out in nature and I've got to clear my head. And he said, as I went out, I laid out that fleece as the prophet did of old, that test of God. And said, God, if you want me to go into ministry, then give me a trophy buck today, and I'll surrender. I've heard of worse ways of doing it. But Ken did. He said he went out hunting that morning, and just as he was about to finish his day's hunt, a beautiful four-point buck, little bitty rack, walked out in front of him. Ken said, I harvested that beautiful buck, and as I approached it, I looked down and I thought, I'm just as confused now as ever. It's not the trophy I had anticipated. And he said, I heard these words, whether they were audible or breathed into my spirit. I heard these words from heaven. Yes, my son, but he's a trophy to me. Friends, remember, I said to you, in the ways of the world, our call, our life's work may not always seem successful or trophies as those who look upon what we do, but friends, I can tell you as one who will witness that when we will follow Christ, it will always be fruitful, for God will take our meager efforts and turn them into a glorious harvest of a trophy that we could have never accomplished on our own. That's the gift of the call. And you know, there's one other gift of the call. My friend Bobby Martin, who's a friend of many of us in this community, in this sanctuary, told me a story once of a fishing trip he took as a young boy. He said he and his little black friend Charles, in the early 40s, when little white boys and little black kids didn't hang out too much together, they went fishing with a mentor of Bobby's who often stayed in the hotel that his mama managed. And he took those boys fishing and they weren't catching anything. And while he wasn't looking, the mentor slipped around and put some of the brim on their hook that he had caught so they could feel the fruit of the fishing trip as well. He never forgot what that man did for him. And he never forgot that he had journeyed with him on that lake that day feeling joy and happiness beyond what he could even express. Friends, why do we embrace God's call? Ultimately, we embrace God's call because we get to fish with the one who made us and saved us. We get to be nurtured by a one who mentors us in a far greater way than Bobby's friend did on that pond bank that day. For the benefit of embracing God's call upon our life is we get to be nurtured and loved by Jesus our Lord, the greatest fisherman the world has known. Would you pray with me? Oh God, we are grateful for your call upon our life. We're grateful, God, that you look upon broken, incomplete individuals like me and all of us who are praying and say, I don't call the equipped, I equip the called. And you use us to be your light and love in spite of our darkness and our unloving spirits at times. And God, there's a beauty. When we journey with you, when we're receptive to follow you, then we know a joy in this world that we would have never known by walking in the wrong direction. We pray, oh Lord, for your church, for the ministry of your church, that you'll inspire and empower the work of this congregation and all congregations that share your light and love and good news. We pray for our nation, for our president, our Senate, the Congress, the Supreme Court. We pray for our state, our county, your city governing bodies throughout our region and the world around us. We do lift up every person on our prayer list as a church and as individuals worshiping together. Friends and family that you called us to minister to most of all, those are closest to us. We ask for miracles of grace. Where there's sickness, oh God, we do ask for healing. Where there's questions and concerns and decisions, God, that you make it clear, and that when their heart's desires for each of us are in accordance with your holy need for their life, we open the floodgates of heaven, pour forth bounteous blessings. God, we don't only pray for our friends and family and those closest to us. Lord, we pray for those furthest from it, those from whom we're estranged, maybe even our enemies. Will you bring healing? Will you soften both of our hearts? Bring restoration? Now, God, as your children, as we pray for each person listening here and with each person, will you pour forth your spirit right now in a knowing way to the prayers that we all lift for one another and with one another? And now, God, we join our voices as one and say together the words you taught us, praying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as we prepare to depart, let us close by affirming our faith and remembering what it is that we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, friends, I offer you this pastoral blessing, that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God who is our Father, and the fellowship and peace of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forever. Amen. Bless y'all. Thank you for joining us today. Hey, Joe, Judy, good to see you all. Stu, I hope you're on there. God bless y'all. Hope you have a great week. Hey, Rita.
Finish.